morning, evening. Sorry, I couldn't think of what time.
Good day.
Good day, then. We are here to talk about Game of Thrones. I'm kidding. We're not talking about Game of Thrones. which did you watch, by the way? Or know anything not. About? Okay.
I know a lot about it. I just haven't watched it since season 7.
Oh, okay. Well,
yeah.
It's been an epic weekend. It's not a word I like to throw around too often because I don't want to diminish the intensity of the weekend it has been. But the weekend ended with the Game of Thrones. Oh my goodness, what is it called? Battle of Winterfell? I don't remember. Yes. But The Long Night. That's the episode title, The Long Night.
Yeah, but it was. It featured the Battle of Winterfell, though.
Yes, it did. It did. But we're not here to talk about that. we are here to talk about... I was trying to think of a fake movie, but I couldn't think of one at the top of my head. But Avengers Endgame, which blew away... I was going to say expectations I've had, but then again, I really didn't know what to expect. I really thoroughly enjoyed myself. The day we're recording this, I went to see it a second time last night. I don't know. I don't think I told you. I don't know if I did tell you, but I did go see it a second time.
No, you didn't.
Yes, I did. I went with my parents because they had to wait like a bunch of other people sometimes either because of scheduling issues or they're out of town or what have you. So we all went together and, you know, we got to chat about it in the car and all that good stuff. And yeah, what are your, like, as soon as you left the theater, and I think I'm not sure if I was one of the first people who talked to you, but what were your initial thoughts or feelings?
So my initial thoughts and feelings was, whoa. I mean, that's it. I mean, I thought it was great. And like, I remember talking to you prior to me seeing it, but it was like right after you first saw it, and you were saying it was a perfect movie. Well, I don't think it's perfect. And I feel like, you know, I've already found a couple of plot holes and a couple of issues, but I thought it was a great movie. I thought it was executed well, despite its flaws. But I did think it was the perfect like ending to the Infinity Saga, or just, you know, I call it phase one of just the Marvel or the MCU, the Marvel Cinematic Universe. But I thought it was just a fitting way to close out what they started 10 years ago. And I don't know, there's a few things I would have done a little bit differently, or even that I expected to be done differently. But overall, I'm happy with how they wrapped it up and how they, I was just very pleased with the story. And it was an entertaining movie. So I was overall happy with it.
As was I. I don't want to feel like I'm recanting my words of calling it a perfect movie, because after more analysis and thought and even the second viewing, I'm like, what about this? What about this? But I'm wondering if that was intentional for us to be asking questions that will be answered later, maybe, because I mean, even like a show like Lost. We'll get to those. like a show like Lost, where everything isn't tied up and answered. And of course also deals with time travel, so that's also something. Yes. And I think that's actually where a lot of my questions and like, well, is this right, kind of lead to. And I'm pretty sure we both talked to other people who have seen the movie and have their own theories and whatnot, some of which wanted to come by and chat with us during this session, but due to scheduling, and I think so many other people having their own special review recap episodes, I think we'll just have to all kind of collaborate and listen to each other's thoughts and opinions. So as for questions that I've had, and I've posed this to other people, so it will be familiar to them, but this will be brand new to you, dear listeners, and probably you, Kortney, because we haven't talked about it because we were planning to do this anyway. So, the most the first question I had, and it's something that did pop up on one of the YouTube videos I watched recently, is regarding the Soul Stone. And if one were to finally achieve and grasp the Soul Stone as Thanos first did, but then Hawkeye later did, or not even later, but actually did before him.
Before, yeah.
And Captain America at the end of the movie went to go return the Soul Stone. What does that actually mean? Does he go up to Red Skull and just hand it to him? And then does it go back into the sky? Or could that mean that we get Black Widow back? Or I mean, even though I think I had brought it up to my parents too, and they were quick on the money, saying like, but no, you there is no going back. There is
Paybacks,
like you
yeah.
there's no take backs, which I would definitely give them that. But still, how what happens when the Soul Stone is returned, and if the timeline were to continue as if they had never taken it, and then Thanos comes along, is the Soul Stone, does it have to come back out of the sky? Does life need to be sacrificed again? My original question was, can you get more than one Soul Stone? Like, can there be like a whole line of people ready to sacrifice their beloved ones, and they all get a Soul Stone? So, but.
So I read a thing about this. I read a couple of articles about it, but my theory is that you make the sacrifice one time, but it can't be undone because the sacrifice was made, period. The only time that I think you could go back and undo it is if you like go back in your own timeline and change your actions in that timeline. But that's not what they did here. So, Thanos first sacrificed Gamora and then the snap. And then 5 years later or so, 5 years or so later, Hawkeye and Black Widow go back, and then before Thanos even found the stone. So they technically obtained the stone before he did. And then the sacrifice was made. Some people think that they like started a whole like new timeline. I don't believe that. I believe they went back into, went back in the current timeline and just made it so that Thanos could not ever make the sacrifice. Now, and to me, that brings us to what happened to Gamora. So if they went back to before he could make the sacrifice, and then like in the movie, the people in from 5 years ago were brought to the current day through the time portal. Well, I don't even know if it's a time portal, but it was just a portal that they, went through. Because remember, Nebula was the connection. And so they came through the portal, and then that's when 5 years ago, Gamora came to the present.
Yes.
Following.
I'm still following. Yes.
So this is before she even met the Guardians of the Galaxy crew, which is why she didn't recognize Peter. And then she went off, and there's a whole different Guardians of the Galaxy 3 plotline for you of them finding more. Anyways, my point is, I don't believe that there's multiple soul stones. I don't believe that, one sacrifice replaces another one. The question of how they put the stones back, though, I don't know, but I don't know that I want to know. I think that takes some of the magic out of, the idea of the infinity stones to begin with. So I don't know. I don't know, but with that one, I'm okay with not knowing.
Yeah, and I also kind of went away from the idea of multiple soul stones, but I think that is just one little piece that I am curious about, that I'm hoping somewhere someone, maybe the Russo brothers, have answers for that particular thing. It's just, just a little minor thing that I was curious about, but I'm probably coming to terms that there are branches of the timeline now because of all the stuff that's happened, because of Thanos coming through to the future, which was not part of the plan. So everything's all jacked up anyway. So, because now he's destroyed rather than being, well, let's see, they came from what,
Right.
2012 or 2014?
12. I think it was 20. Ooh.
I think it's
I don't know.
2014.
I
Yeah, I think
thought it
it's
was
2014.
2012, but I'll take 14.
Yeah, because that's where Peter was when he first got the Power Stone. So that's where
Oh, okay.
he came from. So he's not there when was it 2018 where everything actually he collects everything. So yeah, it's 4 years before the snap, but and then he's just coming through time almost 10 years later. So yeah. Time is now messed up. So, or at
I
least
can live.
it's, I feel like I need to draw like a diagram, but I've already consumed so many YouTube videos of them like showing how if you go back in time or if you go forward in time, you make a new timeline and it's just multiverses is what's
I
happening.
don't know. I like to believe the idea that there aren't multiverses and they truly did like clean up the one timeline. I don't know. Now, I think the ancient one was saying to Hulk that if you take one out, like if you take one of these stones out from its place, then at that time you create an ultimate or an alternate timeline. But then he was like, "Oh, but what if we put them back? Is there a way to do that?" And then when he put it back, like with her little magical simulation, he put the stone back, and then the alternate timeline that the removed stone created was put back in place when he put the stone back in place. So I don't know. I just choose to believe that they altered the timeline that they were in, and that there aren't multiverses out there, not because of that. Like, I believe there's multiverses, but not because of the events of Endgame.
Okay. Well, this is one of those time theories that I mean there are dozens upon dozens of videos in and I would certainly get lost because I just happen to be on YouTube because I just wanted to catch more of the Easter eggs and the whatnots and then the theories it runs deep and every hour there's a new video related to Endgame and the timeline and so forth and so on. So I'm trying not to get too deep into that, and I rather stick to direct quotes from the directors or sources that I trust, because it can get deep and kind of crazy. So, the other question that came up, which came up from my coworker today, he asked me a question which gave me great pause, but I felt like the answer will be discussed in the next movie coming up, which is Spider-Man Far From Home. And that question was, so we know that it's 5 years since people who were snapped away have returned, and Ant-Man goes to see his daughter who is aged 5 years and now is a teenager. Spider-Man at the end of the movie, Peter goes back to school. Is that college or is that high school? We're not sure, but he meets up
It's
with
high
his
school.
friend. It's high
It's
school?
high
Okay.
school.
He meets up with his friend who hasn't seemed to age. So was he snapped up as well, or did he just not age? So.
Yes. No. They aged. So I read an article about this one. I think this was IGN. Or Vulture, one of them. So I've been doing a lot of research too. And I think one of the directors, ooh, I think one of the directors said that 50% of the population, the world's population, or world sentient population, vanished, but 100% of Peter's friends vanished. It was a statement. So I was like, okay, I can buy that because that means nobody would have aged. Everybody would still be, in high school. Now, but and it makes sense, especially with his movie coming out. So like they've got to finish his high school and like teenage journey. So that's a, I'll buy it.
I do as well. And another question, not even question. Was it a question? I don't know, but I'm gonna give a shout out to Mel from Nerds of Prey, who almost joined us, one of the people who almost joined us. She suggested or is wondering exactly when Far From Home takes place. Does it take place between Civil War and Infinity War, or does it take place right after Endgame?
It
which
takes place after Endgame.
okay, because
Yeah,
that.
it's a, yeah, because I think the rumor, I know for sure it takes place after Endgame, but I think the rumor is part of the plot of the movie is how like they're gonna how they're gonna deal with life. Because time has passed, but not for them. And but this actually bears a question for me or creates a question for me. What happened while they were snapped? Like, because Peter was talking, who was he talking to? I think he was talking to Tony when he came back to Tony Stark, and he was like, man, this is hard. One minute we were there, and then one minute we weren't, and then we were coming back, and then Mr. Strange was talking about coming back or something like that. So I'm like, okay, so were they, time may have been different for them, but were they like still conscious
I
while
don't think
being
that they
snapped, or were
were.
they? Okay.
I think maybe they like whatever I was gonna say, whatever it's like going to die and then to come back to life, like we can't really attest to that. We've never
We
had
don't,
that
yeah, we don't
experience.
really know.
But I'm thinking that it was just basically them not experiencing that time. Almost, I was gonna say similar to
Like Ant-Man?
yeah, I was gonna say similar to that, but at least he experienced 5 hours being gone, whereas all
Right.
the people that were dusted away, they didn't experience any time loss. They just like, I don't know what's happening, I don't feel so well, and then boop, they just black out and all of a sudden they're awake again. But unbeknownst to them, it's 5 years later, except for Doctor Strange, who knows because
He
he's Doctor
saw it.
Strange. Yeah.
I guess I'm just that part doesn't jive with me because if they were gone and they didn't experience the time loss, ooh, I mean, maybe it is for them the psychological, you know, trauma of being snapped or dead and then not dead. But if they did not know, like if they didn't feel the they didn't seem to feel a death. Like Spidey could sense it, but he's got Spidey senses. But like everybody else seemed to just kind of fade away. Like, oh, and then they're literally disintegrated. I don't know. I just like how is that going to affect them as a character if it didn't seem to affect them as a character other than making them black out? I don't know. I've fainted before in my life. Is it like fainting? And then you know, you kind of fade away and you can see the blackness coming and then you wake up. Like, I just, it doesn't seem as traumatic to me if that's all it is. I don't know.
And I don't know. I can't say that I would know, 'cause I guess it's basically like dying, but the way that they died is not something natural to us at all. Like no one dusts away when they die. So all that consciousness, it probably just blinks out and then they're back, 'cause we don't know exactly how they come back. Like, do they rematerialize or are they just whoop?
Right, because they just appeared.
Right.
Right.
So I don't know. That's something that's probably going to maybe possibly be explored. I don't know, because this is they're calling this the Infinity Saga since, Iron Man 1 till now. Technically, I do think that Spider-Man Far From Home is included with this, or maybe it's just that's the this is the end of phase three. I think Spider-Man's the end of phase three, but this movie's the end of the Infinity Saga. I don't know. We'll wait until July to see what happens. And then from
That's
there,
right. It is coming out. Oh, that's right. That's exciting.
But I'm most excited to hear what the new slate of next films will be, because hopefully that it may not really relate to this anymore, but at least they'll start up the next quote unquote saga. And just new slew of stories and arcs. Then plus we also have the series that are coming out soon with Winter Soldier and Falcon and Loki, which we now know how his adventures will probably begin because he was
Right.
in prison, but he got the Tesseract, which
Again.
again, yes. So I'm like, oh, I see what you guys did there. I like it. I am. Let me start out by saying that I do like Scarlett Johansson. The Black Widow character is whatever. I really feel this is so many years too late for her to come out with her movie, even if it is an origin story.
Right.
the perfect time for this movie would have been before or after Winter Soldier. That's when I'm kind of nailing it down. So that's my
That makes
opinion.
sense.
Yeah. Because we were still, she was still somewhat new, still exciting. She didn't have her own movie yet. And I'm like, this would have been a good time to introduce her. Like, it's like, okay, now let's back up. Here's her story. But.
And I feel like she, for the longest time, was just pretty background noise. They didn't do enough in the movies to really make us care enough about her or Hawkeye. I feel like he's still the weakest link of the whole bunch in the movies. Like I'm not a comic. I am a fan of comics, but I don't know the comics well, so I don't know how he is in the comics. But in the movies, I feel like he is just the weakest. I mean, he's got his talents, sure. But standing up against everybody else, he just, you know. And so she is kind of the same way to me. She's just very forgettable next to the Titans that she is surrounded by, especially since they've all gotten multiple solo movies. So,
I was not to interrupt your thought, but I was thinking about that during my second viewing about Hawkeye being like I don't want to say not as talented, but not having as much to do, but he did have quite a bit to do in this one.
he
And
did. He
his
did.
strengths, along with Black Widow, is when it comes to hand-to-hand combat, like if when
Yes.
they're in close quarters. Because in the tunnel or when he's running around in the sewer, that's when some of his strengths came in and he was able
And
to
his tactical like training and
sword
strategic.
fighting and all of that. And he was good for that on the ground running because he had to bring the gauntlet out and get it to where it
True,
needs it
that
to
is
be.
true.
So
That's true.
he did that. So he definitely had much more to do, and he was more pivotal to this role. So I guess they were saving him since he wasn't
I
in
guess.
an Infinity War at all. But
I know. Not even at all.
yeah.
Ugh.
So yeah, I mean and he also has a series that's supposed to be coming out too on Disney Plus. So we'll see more of him,
Really?
apparently.
Jeremy Renner is Hawkeye?
Yes, I believe so. Or maybe
Interesting.
something about Kate Bishop, who I'm not familiar with. I don't know if that's a protege of his or what's happening. I don't know. I don't know those specifics. I do know in the comics, his uniform or his costume is ridiculous. So I'm glad that they don't have that. It looks
Expect you to
as
say it was ridiculous.
well, it's I don't know. I'm so glad that they don't do it on screen because, like, really, you're gonna go out in public wearing that? So I feel the same way about Scarlet Witch and her weird red head wrap thing that she has in the comics.
It's
She
pretty
doesn't have
cool, though.
I mean,
It's weird, but it's great. Like,
what does
she's
it do? Does
Scarlet
it serve a
Witch.
purpose? Why do you have that?
You gotta read the comics to see.
I'm not, I don't know if it was like, oh, my head wrap, it helps me focus my brain waves. I don't know.
I mean, Magneto had that thing.
Well, he had a helmet. It serves a purpose.
Yes. So I'm sure hers serves a purpose. Or maybe it's just a really fabulous fashion choice. We never know until we read the comic.
I don't know. The next one that I bring up, it's Marvel related, but it has nothing to do with the movie, is, and I talked to this with Stephanie Williams before about Gambit. Whether you love or hate the character, what is his head gear? What is that for? It doesn't serve a purpose. Some of his hair is like, it's like, makes his hair a little more fashionable, maybe. I don't know. It doesn't
A
seem to
fashion
protect
choice.
his neck.
God, let him live his life.
I mean, he can live his life. I like Gambit. I just want to know what the purpose of his head gear thing is for. Like, why
To
do you
be a
have that?
topic, to be the topic of discussion, clearly.
I guess because it's not hiding his face, so he's not worried about like secrecy.
Identity, yeah.
So, but then again, a lot of the 90s, not a lot of them, but some of them from X-Men, they do have that because even Cyclops, in his blue unitard thing, he's got that too. So I'm just wondering if it's all connected, if it's just like one long zip and then he's just got belt buckles all over. So I don't know. I mean, I don't know. And I'm even that yellow belt or belts that he has, I'm talking about Cyclops still. If those like hold pockets or if they have like, it's like, oh, my I don't know, tracking devices, or if they hold something. Earbuds didn't really happen then. Maybe, I don't know what they're for.
I just like that you're very, very passionate about this, and you really
I
need to know, and you're not going to quit until you do find out.
and and it that's all it is. I just need to know, are these functional? Is this a choice that you thought looked good? I mean, it is the 90s, perhaps. Maybe that's something. And this goes for both Gambit and Cyclops. I just need to know, like, why? What's
We
happening?
just want to know. Inquiring minds want to know.
Rogue has a belt that doesn't fit, but you know, it's
No,
either way.
she did that because it's cute.
It is. It
Well,
is
she
cute.
because she thought it was cute at least.
It to me, it is. I like it. Because I just like the way it just hangs at the side. Because I mean, she's a shapely woman. I'm not gonna beat around that bush at all.
Accentuates her curves.
It does. It does. And the jacket, the whole thing, I love it. I'm here for it. It's just everybody else. Like, get it together. What's going on? I don't understand. But that is another thing. That's another franchise. They'll be joining the MCU later. I don't know if they're going to be bringing their wardrobes with them. But then we can bring up those questions again. Point is,
So,
yes.
well, I have a question. You mentioned that the X-Men were going to be joining the, wait, were you saying X-Men were joining the MCU or Gambit?
X-Men. So probably
Okay.
including Gambit. Hopefully. Hopefully we'll see a
I
Gambit that
mean,
we
I
want.
would think so because he's an X-Man, but I know that they've been talking about this alleged like mysterious Gambit movie forever. Okay,
Starring
bro.
Channing Tatum.
I don't want to talk about it. So yeah, so is Phoenix like the Dark Phoenix played by what's her name? Sansa.
Real name, I don't know, but Sansa, yeah.
I know it's not coming to me though. But they're not part of the MCU right now, right?
No, in fact, I
Or
guess.
ever.
No, I think the marketing is kind of going towards like this is the last one because it literally will be.
She gonna kill
And
everybody.
maybe I and a lot of people, and to be honest, I kept forgetting this movie was coming out until it's like, oh right, this movie is coming out because it's been in the trailer for each movie I've seen the last few weeks. So and I will be seeing it. I don't have very high hopes about it, but I will be seeing it because apparently they have a hard time getting the Phoenix character right, because I tried it before with I think the first trilogy and it looked like they're going the right way. And this was back when we felt that Bryan Singer was a good person, so it looked like they were going in the right direction until
I like the original Phoenix. I don't understand why they, how are we not getting, how are they not getting Dark Phoenix or just Phoenix? How are they not getting her right?
I think because they feel that that's not a story that can be told in one movie because of a
Yeah.
lot of things that's going on. Like I'm
Right.
pretty sure, like and this is a shout out to Mega Sheen. They did a whole episode about the animated version, animated series, the 90s cartoon, as well as the comics. They went back and forth
Oh,
explaining
nice.
her origin story, the Phoenix origin story, not Jean Grey, but
Yeah,
how she
yeah.
became who she was, what she wanted, her motivations, and so forth and so on. So they're going in and with a lot of trepidation to this Dark Phoenix movie coming up.
Yeah.
The Phoenix that we got in X-Men The Last Stand or X-Men 3, that one I don't think was even explicitly called the Phoenix. I don't remember. I just
No,
know it was.
it wasn't just bad Jean Grey.
Yeah. And the other
Don't
thing that.
think maybe they said, but it wasn't like harped on and it was maybe made as a side comment, but it definitely wasn't like the Phoenix.
Right. It wasn't what was alluded to from X2 because we kind of even got like a fiery bird image at the very end if you look close in the water. But in X3, what I could definitely tell was that there was a new director, different director. That was one of the first movies, like as a film goer, as a film fanatic that I am, like, oh, okay, I can tell the styles is different because of.
Yeah, it is different.
Yeah, so
It was
I
a little
really.
bit later too, though, so.
It was. And things were happening. And I'm like, I don't feel right about this. Like, you blew up Professor X. Okay. Well, and
Right.
Scott Summers.
I think she did for real, like in the comics, but it just happened differently. And But don't quote me on this, but I thought that at one point she did do something bad to X.
Probably.
Because she's Dark Phoenix. I mean,
I mean, she does dark things,
she
so.
feels things darkly. So,
And
but yeah. So I just also okay. Also, this isn't the first. This is in like the Days of Future Past. That's not it. First class. This is like the first class X-Men people, right?
yes, like this is the newer batch.
Okay, the newer batch, the rebooted batch. Got it. Okay. So
And I'm
McAvoy and what's his name are gonna be in this movie too?
they're going to be in this one,
Fassbender.
supposedly. Yes. Supposedly Jennifer Lawrence, I guess her character gets killed in this because they're
Yeah,
at a
because I.
funeral scene at some point.
What?
Yeah, which I mean that was like one of the
She's
first
Mystique.
official. She is, but I mean she ended up becoming more prevalent in the series than I think she was supposed to. I think because she just started making it big and then she like won her award. So like, hey, we got to keep putting her in these movies. And
Right.
I'm like, well,
She was
I
like
don't.
not feeling it.
Yeah. And like Mystique wasn't really like an X-Men like that in the comics. I mean, but hey, do your thing. And I don't know. It's like they're forcing her character on us because of
Of
Jennifer
who she's
Lawrence.
played. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm
I
like,
can see
I'm.
that.
And
That's true. That's true because they really played up her and Eric's relationship, which is, I mean, it's a very interesting relationship, very interesting dynamic. But when her and Professor X, but yeah, I don't think it was, she was that prevalent in the source material.
I
But
mean,
she's a great character.
she is, and she does have importance because I believe, at least in the animated series, it's hinted at that she's the mother of Nightcrawler. So, I mean, plus she's blue and he's blue. So,
Yeah, this makes sense.
yeah, it makes sense. But definitely in the first trilogy that we got, we didn't see her nearly as often. Or she, I mean, she was still there, but she wasn't like a central figure. So I don't know.
Well,
But.
and even then, you know, I do like the way I get what you're saying about it feeling more forced. Because of the actress playing her, but I do like the way that they wove that in, how you know, Mystique was basically raised with Charles and how they grew up together and how their relationship went, and like the switch, because she kind of serves as the bridge between I not good and bad, but between the two different thoughts of the mutants and the two different camps of mutants. So I don't know. I do like the way that they executed it, even though it's kind of clear that they played her up more than like the comics did. I don't know. I bought it.
Yeah,
Made sense to me.
I was on board. I think it was just in the later movies. I'm like, okay, I would like to see some other mutants now, please. Thank you. So,
I agree. I agree.
that's something that we have looked forward to. And I heard rumor that they could start shooting new X-Men, like brand new X-Men, maybe as early as next year, maybe. If not then, maybe year after. I don't know. I have no idea. I have to. That's not something I was prepared to talk about because
Right.
of what we do in just tangents. And I'm trying to get back to one other, some other. There are other points in Endgame.
So many other
So
points.
many other points. Like, still one of my favorite highlights of the film is Captain America being worthy, and it was just the way that that scene was
Yes.
set up, where
Yes.
we were on. Another one of those cliffs of despair, like, oh no, Thor is
We're
about
gonna die.
to
Yeah.
get
This
what
isn't
he was
good.
doing to Thanos and shoving
Right.
that axe in his chest. And then we see Mjolnir being lifted, like, okay, he's gonna get his hammer back, but like, no, not him. It was Captain America. And
Right.
oh, what's happening? And then all
It
of a sudden
was
he's
so good.
fighting with that and the shield back and forth and just
Oh, so good, that whole scene. And then it's like he becomes the freaking god of thunder, and he
Yes.
starts calling down lightning and into Mjolnir, and I'm like, what? Captain America, I see you.
I
Okay.
didn't know that could happen, and I loved it.
Me either. And I love loved it. I was a little confused, like, what? Uh-huh, okay. And that was like, that was my like real-time reaction. But it was amazing.
It was so amazing. I wanted to stand up and cheer the first time. The second time, the audience I was with, they really got into it. And I'm like, yes, you guys are all feeling how I'm feeling right now. This is great. Because, I mean, for me, I think that may have been like one of my favorite scenes. Like, I couldn't wait to get back to the theater to see that scene specifically.
Yeah, yeah, it was a great scene. It was really good. Like, I still think about it just randomly. Like, dang, Captain America really did like handle Mjolnir like he owned it. Oh, it
after
so
watching
good.
Thor for like so many years, like he knew exactly like how to use it, and then plus right. his own training on just how to, you know, handle weapons, and it's like this is great, and how well he uses that weapon with his shield.
Yes, and I love how he uses his shield, and like when he throws it like a boomerang, like I just love it. So side note, there is a, are you familiar with the song Old Town Road by Lil Nas, and now featuring on the remix Billy Ray Cyrus? So there's a crazy fan out there who actually did a montage of like a bunch of Captain America fight scenes where he's throwing the throwing the shield and like just doing his hand-to-hand combat thing, but it's set to the tune of Old Town Road.
Wow.
And it's amazing. I will send it to you.
Well, yes, I think you should. Have you watched the one I sent you at all?
Sent me a thing? No, I didn't. I'm sorry.
Yes.
I'm sorry. Terrible. The one about the Night King in Old Town.
Yes. Yes.
I have not.
Terrible.
I know.
I try to keep you caught up on these things that I find, so you don't yell at me later. Like, why didn't you jump? It's like, I sent these to you, and I'll pull up receipts.
That only happened like one time. So hush.
Well, there's that, and then I think I did send you the thing about the black hole.
Yeah.
Anyway, there was that scene, and of course they. Thor and Captain America at some point trade weapons, and then he's like, no,
yes,
one, and then
goes back to having his axe. Right, because he wanted the axe, which is a pretty cool axe.
It's not to be messed with. Yes.
No.
The other great moment, which was for me, I describe as a explosion in slow motion, and that is when who takes it from? I think it was Captain Marvel who took the gauntlet from Spider-Man, and then she basically all the female characters come to say, like, you know, she's not alone, or she's we're going to help her bring this over, and all of them just jump in, and I'm like, yes, and love the girl power. Just it was amazing. And
so my thoughts about that scene, I was geeked about it, but I was also just like, oh, because it screamed of girl power, like as if it was screaming in your face, like, or shoving it down your throat. Pick your analogy. So I loved it, and I love seeing all the girls together, but it was just like, it was a bit much. It was a bit forced. That was forced to me. And so, because at first, you know, when I first saw, like, I think it was Valkyrie and Black Widow and a couple of other ones, and then you saw, like, the Wasp and Pepper Potts / Stark, I don't know what her legal name is, but I don't know. It was just like, I don't know. Now you're just throwing every girl in there. You're going to throw a girl who's on the opposite team in there just to make a point or something. It was just a bit forced to me. I loved it. I liked it a lot, but it was like, all right, guys, I got it. I got it. Thanks.
What I was curious about was what was Mantis doing? Like, I know she was part of the group. I did see her.
She was kicking it. I don't know what she was doing. She went on the battlefield, though.
She was on the battlefield, and she did join in with the girl mob. So I'm like,
See, there you go. I didn't even forgot. But I'm sure I saw her and was like, wait a second. Why Are you here? What you gonna do?
Right. And this was something I learned from other people who are more comics based, that she does know how to fight, but we have never seen that like in the movies, really. Just
Right.
putting
Well,
people to
she's
sleep.
new. She's newer.
Yeah. And maybe, you know, she has had some training or something and actually does some fighting. I don't know. All
Yeah.
I've seen her do is just, you know, use her powers to incapacitate people, which isn't bad. It's not a
It's
bad
pretty great, but
thing.
I can't. I don't know. I haven't. It's hard to envision that in action. I'm with you on that one.
And of course, the only person that wasn't there was Black Widow because she's dead. So
Oh, why did you sit there like that though?
as I said it, I'm like, wow, I didn't have to be so crass about it. Just like, so matter of fact, yeah, she's dead now.
Right.
Like, don't bring her up.
Right. Like, ouch. That hurt my feelings.
I'm sorry. And what I meant to say about Scarlett Johansson, and like, aside from all the controversy of her being, you know, cast in movies that she shouldn't have been cast in, and
People of
probably
color.
right, and probably whenever that came up is when she said, you know, let's do a Black Widow movie instead. Then maybe we would have been more receptive to it, perhaps.
Maybe.
Yeah, maybe. Still the timing. But the
Yeah.
one of my favorite roles of hers is her, when she plays the voice of like some AI phone, smartphone theory, because for me, that's one of my favorite things about her. Like, I love her voice. It's just like
Yeah.
so sultry and smoky and just like, yes, just keep speaking to me. So that's always kind of like my thing, why I'm not like I don't write her off,
Hater.
because yeah, because I like listening to her. So I'm here for that, or at least I was, since she's no longer with us. Is that a little more gentler?
Well, sure.
Yeah, in this moral MCU plane.
And you know what? I bet this was casting. I don't know if she died in the comics or if she died in this way in the comics. I'm pretty sure she didn't. Not to get the soul stone, but I bet this is one of the reasons they set it up like this and killed her so that we would have sympathy for her and actually like her and want more of her. And then bam, solo movie. But it's a prequel, but we still see more of her. So, I mean, I feel like this is just the marketing genius of the Marvel Studios, as a way to set this up for her and, do the thing. Whether it works or not, we'll see. But, I think the masses tend to like Black Widow and want more of her. So,
Well,
I can't hate the
see.
can't hate the game,
I know, and I my optimism or my is it my optimism? I don't know. I don't feel like it's going to hit as strongly, because it's almost like she missed. No, not her specifically. I'm just talking about the character of the movie. It missed time frame because.
Yeah, I'm with you, but I think that's why they did this like this.
Because I'm thinking of, what is it? Red Sparrow, which again is I almost said Scarlett Johansson, Jennifer Lawrence, and then there's Atomic Blonde. These two movies seeming to have similar themes as to Black Widow, as well as being colors. So, you know, if we've got that going, although Atomic really wouldn't be a color. Oh no, Blonde is the color. Okay, so yeah, got Atomic Blonde, Red Sparrow, Black Widow. They can all team up together. That might be interesting. Maybe. No, not really. No, I take it back.
Take it
Yeah, sorry. I'm so sorry.
back.
You can make it a little bit worse and throw some diversity in there, and jump in with oh man, I wanted to call her Foxy Brown, but her name was Proud Mary. But no, never mind. Forget it. We are moving along. Let's see. There was the scene. Now, you did say you were crying, or were you bawling? Where there's many tears, no tears.
No, there were tears. There were a few tears. I wasn't bawling, but I was like pr I haven't cried that hard in a movie in a long time. Like Captain Marvel and Black Panther have made me shed tears because I was just like so overwhelmed by what I was seeing on Moana made me cry. But I haven't like just like flowing tears in a while, and this movie definitely did it for me. when Iron Man was transitioning into his next phase of existence, non-existence. I don't know what to call. So he was leaving this earth, and Pepper was talking to him, and she was like, we'll be okay, rest, or it's time, you can rest now. I just was like, oh God, oh my God, this is a callback to when he was first fi when he first figured out the time travel issue, and he's like, I don't want to undo this. This is my life now. We were the lucky ones, And then he's like, I could just walk away from them. I could sleep peacefully, or I could sleep at night knowing, whatever. And then she's like, but bro, would you be able to rest? Like, it was so deep and so profound, and she was right. He wouldn't be able to sleep well about that, knowing that he could bring everybody back. And then, of course, we know that they found a way to keep everybody, which I thought was also brilliant, because we all kind of theorized that time travel would have something to do with getting everybody back, but I did not realize that, or I hadn't really considered that they would just bring people back rather than reverse time. And so I love the way they did that. I love that little Morgan, Iron Man's daughter, is still with us, and everything that happened with Pepper and him is still there because they didn't change their timeline. I just thought that was a brilliant use of time travel.
I did too,
But
as well as
then when, oh, go
acknowledging other
ahead.
time travel movies, because
Yes, yes,
yeah,
yes.
I loved all of that, and like I'm just nerding out about all of this.
Yes, I love it. I love it. That, to me, that's breaking the fourth wall just a bit, because they're talking to us. Kind of like when Cap whispered over to the Hydra agent, "Hail Hydra." I was like, that is a direct response to the controversy, and you people, you brilliantly used it in this movie.
They not only did they do that, I mean, they did two things in that one scene. It was a callback to Winter Soldier, and it was a
Yes, in
call
the elevator. Yeah. Yes.
because
Oh, so good.
yes, and I
So
mean,
good.
and that's why people were calling this a love letter to the fans and fan service, and I'm here for it. I'm like,
I
yeah.
agree. I really think it was. And did you see that stupid article going around? I think it was started going around today, talking about how Endgame, what is it? Something about Endgame not doing, or how it disregards non-fans. Have you seen that?
I didn't.
So that was just the title, or it was something of that nature, but it reading the comments, because the comments reveals most things, and so apparently some people had clicked it and read it, and they were just like, this is basically saying the equivalent of opening a book that has 22 chapters, reading the 22nd chapter, and then
You should have gone for the head.
That was Thanos snapping the last half of this podcast episode. If you want to hear this episode in its entirety, head on over to patreon.com/endube.